From my understanding. But I ask you, Lord, to enlarge all of our minds and our understanding. So we ask a blessing on this word, Lord. And I thank you for the opportunity to present your word. Acts 2:14. Verse 14 says, "Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Peter said, 'Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say.'"
Yes.
And then verses 36 to 41 says, "Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart."
Yes.
"And said to Peter and the other apostles, 'Brothers, what shall we do?' Peter replied, 'Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call.' With many other words, he warned them, and he pleaded with them, 'Save yourselves from this corrupt generation.' Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day." Thanks be to God. This is the word of the Lord. I would like to present this text in this manner.
Yes.
And with this title: What kind of love is this? What kind of love is this? I know that if you're my age, maybe a few years behind me, you might remember that there was this songwriter named Burt Bacharach.
Yes.
And he was, to me, in my opinion, one of the best writers there were as far as the words that he presented in his music.
Well,
his songs were popularized by a woman named Dionne Warwick.
Yes.
Maybe you'll remember Dionne Warwick. I know some of you may and some of you may not. But there's one song that I was thinking about when I was writing this sermon, so I'm going to be honest about that, but it was about this song called Alfie. So I'm going to review those words to you for a moment, and it went like this. What's it all about, Alfie? Is it just for the moment we live? What's it all about when you sort it out, Alfie? Are we meant to take more than we give? Or are we meant to be kind? And if only fools are kind, Alfie, then I guess it's wise to be cruel. And if life belongs only to the strong, Alfie, what will you lend on an old golden rule? As sure as I believe, there's a heaven above, Alfie, I know there's something much more, something even non-believers can believe in. I believe in love." It's a catchy tune, and it seems to have some hints of the gospel in it.
Well,
it has some hints of gospel truth. I believe in love. Love is a love word that we use so often, but it's a word that is so profound. But the most profound thing that we can find through the gospel and even in the song is the love of Christ, which is so profound. The love of Christ is so amazing. I believe in that love. Do you believe in that love? The love of Christ? I want to go through this because I want you to really get it. We just came through a period of resurrection. And we just go through it and we just talk about it, but we don't stay there and really get ourselves marinated on what that really, really means. What about you?
Yeah.
From what I've learned from my short stay here on earth, there are those who believe in love and those who believe not. As much as Jesus, while he was on this earth, demonstrated love, there were still people who did not believe. This is unbelievable. I used to think, well, show me, you know, because I used to be like Doubting Thomas, show me, you know, I'll believe then. But, you know, there has been so much that happens in our lives that we have got to believe that it's nothing but God and God's love that has been presented to us. We weren't there when he showed all the miracles, but we believe because we had eyewitnesses who told us the truth about that. And we choose to believe because we believe in the love of God. And so in every time and in every place, even when there have been signs and proofs and wonders, even today, we still don't believe. What more can God say? What more can God say? And are we meant to take more than we give? Can non-believers believe? What are we here for? We are to be light in this dark world. We are to shine God's love continually. Are we doing that? Can we ask ourselves when we get up every day, like I do, sometimes I'm so grumpy. Sometimes I go out today, I'm complaining. Something's going wrong again. Nothing ever goes right. I can't be nowhere on time. I am so sick of this. You know, I'm always forgetting something or leaving something. I'm complaining. And I got to think about, I got up.
Well,
I was on my feet. I had a car to drive in. I got to where I was going. And I was complaining. I got to stop that. And I own it. And I have been working on it. And I'm going to get it till I get it right. How about you? Do you still complain? You still got eyes to see, ears to hear? We got food on our table. We woke up. I don't care if it was raining. The roof didn't cave in. We have the love of God every minute of the day when we can still breathe and have our being. So everybody needs to say amen.
Amen.
What more can God believe? So let's look at the text. Peter chapter 2 and verse 14. This was after the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And after the proof of his resurrection had been provided to his disciples, and after he had stamped himself upon the minds and souls of the disciples and the people that he showed himself to, after he has left his stamp on their lives, after he had provided proof to the witnesses of his resurrection, Jesus enabled the disciples to become better witnesses to both Israel and the world. And that's the same thing he wants us to do today. He wants us to be better witnesses to the world. So, get this. Jesus gave his disciples new beginnings. He gave them wonder of all wonders. He gave them grace upon grace. Jesus still makes certain there are no stones unturned. He didn't leave anything unturned. He provided everything. He could have died, was resurrected, and went on his way. But he still knew he had people who were still doubtful, people who still weren't certain, people who, like Don Thomas, got to have some proof. He provided proof.
Yes.
He didn't leave any stone unturned for anybody to dispute that he was not risen from the dead. So we thank him for that. One of his disciples, who had been Jesus' own friend, who had walked with him, talked with him, and saw his miracles, three times betrayed him.
Yeah.
Three times Peter betrayed him.
Yeah.
His tongue became tied. And that's what marveled me. That was what I really couldn't get over, what I had to really grapple with, that Peter, a betrayer, betrayed Jesus in the time of his need, said he didn't even know him, never knew who they were talking about. He wasn't one of them. Peter, a betrayer, gets up, and what is he doing in this verse? He's preaching.
Come on now.
He gets up to preach about somebody he betrayed. His mouth opens. His heart is opened.
Yes.
He has been given another chance to get it right.
Yes.
Even though he betrayed Jesus, his friend. How many of you have ever been betrayed?
Yes.
I know what that feels like.
Well,
every time I see a person who was a friend of mine that betrayed me, and she doesn't even know this till the day, my mind goes back to the time she betrayed me. It just pops up just like that, like an instant. And I have to work on, she might have changed today. She can't be like it was when we were in high school.
Oh, she changed.
But you go right back to it. So just imagine how much Jesus loves us, that he allowed us another chance to get it right. Peter stands before the people, and he is representing the apostles.
Yes.
He's representing the 11 apostles that's left. Now, isn't that amazing?
Yes.
That's how good God is. That's how much he loves us. Peter, who always said he would die for Jesus, and like I said, Peter, who betrayed him in his time of need, is preaching, y'all.
Yes.
He's declaring the word, and he is spreading the word. He's spreading the gospel. And I still say that's how God works in mysterious ways. He really does. So that's what I want you to realize. And I'm going to give you another person that was betrayed. And I thought about this because in your hour of betrayal, you can't get over it. You say, I can't believe it. And so I remember I always had to learn Shakespeare when we were in high school. I don't know about Bishop Redfern, but we had teachers who made us study, you know, Shakespeare, and there was this character in Shakespeare that was very popular, and he was Julius Caesar, and Julius Caesar was also betrayed, and he was betrayed by who? His best friend. And his best friend stabbed him in the back, and he lived long enough to look at his best friend and say, "Hey, too, Brutus?" He said, "You too, of all people? My best friend, to die with that lingering on your last breath, that your friend betrayed you?" So I want to ask you, don't you think Jesus had some feelings when he was betrayed? Don't you think he was hurt and disappointed? He was a human being walking on this earth, giving his life for us. But he felt hurt and pain. You know how we know? He shed blood. His tears were filled with blood. His tears were bloody in his hour of need, when he knew that he had to give up his life and be abused and brutalized and betrayed and mistreated and rejected. He went through a lot. And I tell you, me and my mom were screaming the other day because we decided we were going to watch The Passion of the Christ.
Yeah.
We watch The Passion, we start screaming because the first thing we see is this evil snake all over the place. And then we couldn't watch Jesus being brutalized. It gave us an opportunity, even though it was in a picture movie form, to see what it must have really been like. It wasn't no comedy. It was for real.
Yeah.
Jesus was brutally beat. And I can't imagine how you're going to ask a brutally beaten man to carry his own cross. That was ludicrous. Man is so cruel. How could you do another human being like that? That's what I can't understand. How could you do anybody like that? You wouldn't want your sister or brother or your mother or anybody to do that. And they seem to take joy in it and pleasure in it. And so Jesus did all that for us. And here we have, again, a forgiven Christ who forgives us. He died for people who brutally beat him. I'm telling you. And we need to be grateful. We got to learn to express gratitude for that kind of love. What love is this? That Jesus would shed his own blood. Jesus who died for a wretch like Peter. And Jesus who died for such miserable wretches like you and me. It's so unbelievable. It's still unbelievable to me. I still can't imagine that kind of love because I get upset when somebody hurt my feeling and somebody don't love me like I think they should love me because I love them, you know, and I don't get reciprocated. I'm like, I'm hurt. So it's just too amazing that Jesus, the gift giver, the giver of his own life, the giver of life, continues to give even after he ascends into heaven. So Jesus, what does he do? Jesus bestows another gift. The gifts upon gifts gives another mighty miracle which came in the sound of a violent rushing wind, blowing with tongues of fire. He's transforming the tongues of the disciples and so they could be witnesses for all to understand. And he also gave the voice to other people. Everybody in that room was given the Holy Spirit. What a gift to give. He said, I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm still going to give you something. I'm going on, but I'm going to still be with you. I don't care what you go through, I'm with you. I don't care what you're feeling, I'm with you. I don't care if you betray me, sin over and over again. I'm still with you. If you believe in me, if you trust me, if you give me your life, I will be with you. And that is what kind of love we have with Jesus Christ. So here we go, Lord. I thank you for giving me the opportunity to stand before you today, Lord, because I really don't see myself as preaching. And I have been a betrayer just like Peter. I have not always been faithful to you, Lord. And I ask your forgiveness, and I ask you the forgiveness of all of us here in the sound of my voice that do the same thing repeatedly. We repeatedly betray you, Lord. Forgive us, Lord. We're going to get it right because you said you will pick us up and let us start over again. We thank you for the witness of Peter, Lord. We thank you for his tongue becoming untied. And Peter boldly speaks now, Lord. Peter delivers a powerful message, beginning with the prophecy of Joel. Joel had already prophesied this day would come. He always said this was going to happen. And so Peter, he want to make sure we get it right too. He wants us to understand too. So what does Peter do? Peter said, we're not drunk. We are not babbling all over the place. What is happening here is that the Holy Spirit has been filling our hearts and minds and soul. So he addressed them, and he wanted to get it straight. I'm speaking for Jesus now. You're not going to say something bad to my Lord that we're up here drunk because we're filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm going to get this straight, and that's what he did. So in that day, you know, it was unspeakable anyway to be drunk so early in the day. About 9 o'clock in the morning. You know, the believer's experience of the Holy Spirit's fullness seemed to look to others like intoxication, but it was because they had lost control of their normal mental and physical functions. They were beside themselves. It was something that never been happened before. This was something brand new. Nobody really understood it, but it was happening. Peter reminds those listening of the prophecy of Joel, and he tells them that wise men, that young men were to see visions. and old men would dream dreams. And what kind of love is this? That God's servants, both men and women, were to receive the promised Holy Spirit, and they were to prophesy. Yeah. This is significant. There's no social distinction here. There's no gender distinction here. Both men and women were qualified to be God's ministers. And Peter, in the midst of this great outpouring of Holy Spirit, among signs and wonders and among speaking in tongues, what does Peter do? He said, let's have a Bible study. Let's study what the prophet Joel said. Right. So Peter explained that Joel had predicted that God would show wonders in the sky and signs of the earth, and that he even explained the prophecy that's going to come, and he was explaining what's happening right now, that in the end times, there are going to be some more things happening. And he was preparing the people to understand that what happened on the day of Pentecost was a near fulfillment of that promise, with the final fulfillment coming in the last days, which Peter has good reason to believe in. Peter has witnessed a lot. Peter has seen the truth. The truth has been revealed to him. No longer will his tongue be tied. No longer will he betray God. His life changed, and it changed for the better. The Spirit began with the coming of the Holy Spirit. It brought on the birth of the Christian church, which was part of the beginning of the end. Peter preaches that God proved Jesus of Nazareth was the Messiah who provided the signs of divine mediator. Peter was adamant about Jesus' crucifixion being a divine act and that it was a fulfillment of God's eternal purpose. Peter insisted that Jesus' crucifixion was not the consequence of a human plot, but was a fulfillment of God's eternal plan.
All right.
Not that the people who crucified Jesus was innocent of their evil deed, and they were not the only ones responsible for Jesus' death. Peter, as a result of a human plot or deed by human beings, made the people understand that we all were guilty. The crowd standing there looking were guilty. The bystanders, the people who did nothing, they were just as guilty. And so Peter gave them, too, an opportunity to get it right. He gave them an opportunity to change. What does he do next? When they ask the question, what can we do to be saved? What did Peter say, y'all? He said, repent and be baptized. And that is when 3,000 people came and were saved and were baptized and became believers. And I can imagine in my mind's eye those 3,000 people going and telling somebody else, and it multiplied to be 3,000 more and 3,000 more and 3,000 more. So the day that this happened, the beginning of what we now call church began. And now we have church. And no matter whether it's 3,000 or 3, we can praise the Lord. Because what kind of love is this? That Jesus would die for such wretches as us. What love is this? That God allows common man to spread the gospel. Nobody greater than Jesus. Greater love than this. To give us life. Not just in heaven, but in the here and now. Jesus, in all his action, showed that he loved us. And he taught us as he healed. He demonstrated how we should love. He provided all that he could touch, the opportunity through the sacrifice of his death and the act of his love and the power of his love to radically change the world. May you be forever reminded that the love Jesus had for you each day we breathe, it is love. Each day we sing and give him praise, he sends a burning in our hearts. Can't you just feel it? When those men walked on the road of Emmaus talking to God, they felt a burning in their heart. When we stay in the Word of God, we feel a burning in our hearts. When our mind stays on Jesus, we feel a burning in our hearts. And we feel that redeemed by the love and the blood of Christ, we can say thanks be to God, who will never, ever betray us. He is love. He is true love. And He's never failing love. He is love. And so love one another the way He has loved you. This is the very best way we can show love. We can go tell it. We can spread the word. We can love the gospel. We can shout it to the roof. We can say it with a smile. We can say it with a hello. And we can say it with a helping hand. And we can say it to everyone in the sound of our voice. We can say, God is love. Amen. 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 God is love.